Your advertisement here.
Oh, I got a little foggy there. Need more caffeine. Good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning, Brent.
Good morning, guys.
Good morning, Will. And good morning to everybody in the chat. Lots of folks chiming in with their weather report. That's always fun. Oh, Becky's saying it's sunny and will be 90 in Vegas. Jerks.
Oof. Well, we're 100, so.
Oh. Yeah, oh. We're going up to, I think, 13, 14 Celsius. Something like that.
What is in American?
What's that in American? Ah, that is negative 4,000 American degrees. It's a conversion formula. You have to remember that you have to divide by 5/9.
It is embarrassing when you talk to somebody who's not from the United States and you can't in your head, calculate the temperature to their temperature to Celsius. Mm.
Well, my trick is I picture a thermostat and then I try to figure out how it relates to that, because like 21 Celsius is around 72 Fahrenheit, and most of our thermostats have the have both sort of, so you kind of remember, you think of it in relationship to, anyway, I do, in relationship to room temperature. And then I kind of fudge it after that, so. Then add 32, Kurt's telling me. Yeah, thanks, Kurt.
Hey, everybody, we have a guest today. Who do we have today, Chris?
Who do we have today? Well, we have Dr. Will Thalheimer joining us today. And as we were talking, Will was our first guest of the year for 2020. And back then in January, we had no suspicion that things could actually feel so ominous ahead of us. For the folks who haven't met you before, Will, maybe give us your quick bio, introduce yourself to the crowd.
Oh, yeah. So I've been in this learning and development field for over 30 years. For the last 21, I've been running my consulting practice, work learning research. And basically there, I try to compile or translate the scientific referee journals on learning, memory, and instruction, and then translate that into practical recommendations for trainers, learning designers, e-learning developers, chief learning officers, et cetera. And I also dabble in things like learning evaluation and presentation science and all kind of fun stuff.
Very cool. And you are a very, prominent's not the word I was gonna use, but a very, you share a lot of great stuff on your site. There's lots of reports and things that people can go, to get access to a lot of what you do share as research, et cetera. That's what I think I wanted to say. I haven't had enough coffee yet this morning.
That's okay. I am working on trying to become prominent. I hope someday that I can.
I thought that happened as soon as you got the PhD done. I thought the prominence was just mandated.
Well, it's funny you say that, because I started a job right after that, and they told me, listen, we want you teaching leadership training. I said, well, I don't really know all that much about leadership. Hey, you have a PhD, you can teach it, but my PhD is not in leadership. Go ahead. Do it.
Hi, welcome to the world of corporate training, ladies and gentlemen.
my previous career was in journalism, and we had a one panel cartoon up on the cork board in our office, and it had a journalist with a blindfold on, and it said, "Today I am an expert in," and then there on the far side was a wall with cards with words on it, and he was throwing a dart. At things like politics, science, biology, or whatever. Today, I'm an expert in. So anyway.
That's great.
I sometimes feel that's a very apt thing for us in our world as well. We get expected to get involved in and do get involved in so many things that are not in our standard wheelhouse or things that we know. One of the perks, I think, of the job, too.
Well, I mean, you notice probably that there's like now we have a million, I think it's 1,000,004 experts on how to go virtual.
And, yeah.
This is true. Well, hey, you know what? Who would have thought that in January, if somebody had predicted virtual online training is going to go 100%, everybody is going to be on it. Everybody would have laughed them out of the room.
Yeah.
Well, it's sort of the dream of some people have always had this as the annual. We were talking about annual predictions, right? How every year seems to be the year of mobile. Every year seems to be the year of video coming up. But interesting how context can suddenly force us to jump into new things for sure. If you weren't already doing that kind of thing.
So remind me, guys, we were predicting the future back in January and. Is that what we were doing? Oh my God! I see you shaking your head.
That's what everybody does, right?
Well, yeah, but now, do you promise that you won't like play them back to back? You know, this one.
Yeah, yeah.
Thalheimer reported back in.
Don't worry about it.
I think your most prominent prediction was that most of us. Would actually be able to convert our tinfoil hats into mobile receptor devices so we could take training everywhere.
Oh, I think I did say that. Yeah. I also probably. Mentioned something about did I say anything about a hoax? It was a big hoax. It was all going to be a hoax.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think you covered that.
We'd have a cure for bad training and there's going to be a cure for bad training by Easter. I'm pretty sure I said that.
Yeah, a vaccination against it, we'd be immune.
I'm certain we set April 1st as the date. It's what I had on my calendar.
Very cool.
But who knows?
But we are officially then talking today about the structural state of the L&D field. May a chance to talk about some of the things that you've been observing, Will, as changes, things that people have to be doing differently, good things that maybe people should be thinking about.
Well, whenever anybody asks me to predict the future, I try to start out by saying that nobody's good at predicting the future, not Nostradamus, not the futurist you hear out there. So I am not going to claim that I know where things are headed.
Mm.
But obviously all of us have seen this massive move to virtual training. And unfortunately, we're not ready for it. Even with all the webinars out there that you can go upskill yourself. I have to tell you a funny story. So my daughter's 17 and she's beginning to think about colleges and that kind of thing. And the local, it's a prominent university in the Massachusetts area. And they were, invited students, high school students and their parents to come join them in this webinar for 90 minutes. They were going to tell you all about how to think about getting into college, but also to mention how great their university was. So it starts out and there's a little MC and then the president of the university is speaking and he is reading a teleprompted script in the most monotone, unappealing, no emotion, no bonding with the audience kind of way. And it got worse from there. It was just, how can you do this? And then other people, you're on online meetings and they're not looking at the camera. They're looking over here. And then, just crazy stuff. You just.
Can you guys see me?
I know you can't go to the dentist these days either, Chet, Brent. So we can help you there. Virtual dentistry.
So. It's funny how some people, the monotony, that fear of risk, right? Trying to control actually ends up, backfiring by having everything perfectly scripted. It actually loses the audience in that way.
I thought it was, I actually reached out to this university and said, hey, here's some ideas for you. Because it was a PR disaster for them.
Yeah, yeah.
If you're my daughter even, unscripted by us or unprompted by us, she went down and said, that guy was reading a script. So. If you're trying to relate to people and be persuasive, you need to do better than that. So that's, obviously one thing. going on, and we do need to do that. I think it's going to be interesting. You know, everybody's defaulting to sort of these synchronous sessions, but I think we're going to learn that that's not great. I mean, it's okay. And we can do those a lot better. Clients are coming to me and say, hey, Will, how do we teach online? And I've got great stuff for them. But I think asynchronous is going to be an opportunity as well. It's a little bit harder. People aren't used to it. You know, if you take a speaker or a presenter or a trainer who's done it in the classroom to go online, you know, it's a fairly, you know, comfortable transition, not super comfortable, but, you know, but much easier than like to go into an asynchronous thing where you have, you know, activities and discussions and things, and you're weaving that together and you're creating videos and things. So I think asynchronous is going to be something we go towards as well.
Is this something that's going to, from a, I mean, obviously we can't, like you said, we can't predict the future, but if it changes at all going forward, like obviously there was a massive change when all of a sudden everybody had to stay home and everybody tried to just basically, are we just putting a Band-Aid on it, or is this sort of here to stay? I think that's sort of the magic crystal ball everybody's looking into these days from an industry-wide perspective. Do you think this really, like, those of us that are really positive about it are like, everything has changed and this is going to be great. But I have this other voice in my head that says, it feels like a lot of companies, when this thing is over or kind of getting close to wrapping up, whatever happens, they're going to say, yeah, we want to go back to business as usual and bring everybody back into the office and try to go back to normal.
Yeah, well, but how long are we going to be doing this for? I mean, you know, we're sheltering in place, and we could shelter in place for a year or something. And I think people will learn, hey, this isn't so bad, or hey, we've learned how to do this. You know, part of the reason we didn't do it before was that we didn't have comfort with it. We didn't try it. So now we're trying it, and we're going to mess things up, of course. So that's, there could be some backlash. It's, you know, like, I have this online workshop called Presentation Science, and I offer it free to any, during the coronavirus, to any teacher, any professor, and like over 350 people from around the world have signed up and have taken that now. And what I've heard from them is, oh my gosh, all of a sudden people are telling me to teach online. I have no idea. So I think there's a lot of freaking out, but I think people are going to try stuff out. For some organizations, they're going to want to go back. I just saw that on LinkedIn, a comment. Oh yeah, this online stuff's okay, but really you've got to have face-to-face contact. And you know, that's not really true. There's this research review I did a few years ago showed that e-learning can be more effective than classroom training. In fact, if you just tell people to create the best classroom training and the best e-learning tends to outperform classroom training. So there's no slam dunk on what's better.
Mm-hmm. And in that data, what were some of the reasons that made that e-learning actually better than
well, an equivalent instructor-led? Well, one thing I should say, first of all, that both e-learning and classroom should be much better designed. Okay? Mm-hmm. But if you just, you know, if you compare them, and I'll another subtlety about the research, if you use the same learning method in both, so if you lecture online, if you lecture in the classroom, or you have an animation online, an animation in the classroom, video in the classroom, video online, if you can, you know, completely equate those on both, they're going to be equal. But what happens is that in the classroom, we tend to just present, maybe with a few discussions. But online, we know we can't just do that. So we have more interactivity, a little bit more practice, et cetera. So there's more interactivity there. So I think that's why e-learning tends to be better. But again, e-learning can be even much better than that.
Mm-hmm. It can be. Well, then why don't we do much better than that? Something we need to go for, and something we need to stretch for. What do we look at from an industry perspective? Sorry, I don't mean to change the subject on it, but when we're looking at this, one of the things that I often find with conversations with folks that I have is that there is a big, big difference between what we provide as an industry. And when we're talking about industry trends, that the trends seem to be very different for the very large corporations down to the smaller businesses. You know, when you're talking about dozens to maybe hundreds of employees versus thousands and tens of thousands, there's the trends that one sector might be going through is very different than the trends that others are going through.
Well, tell me what you've seen. I'm not sure.
Yeah. Well, I mean, some are stuck in the classroom, right? And some are okay with that. And they want to stay there, and that works. You know, from a small end perspective, right? They don't have the money to spend on really expensive e-learning. And so they're okay with using their subject matter experts because maybe they don't have that many people that they need to teach. They can video record that person or whatever, and they feel good about that. So they're not interested in doing anything else other than that. But then you have a big company that maybe has built a massive like corporate university, and they send all of their new people into this university, an 8-week program or something. And then they've got these fancy management leadership programs that are on site in these really cool places, right? I mean, so there's all of these different sort of levels and versions of what a training professional can be and do, depending upon the size of the company you're in.
Well, let me give an example from my wife's organization. She runs a small not-for-profit that helps farmers in New England and New York. And they teach farmers things, well, they call it technical assistance, but it basically means teaching them about how to run a business. You know, one of the things, you know, new farmers get caught up on is, hey, you're not just a farmer, you're a business person now. And you need to know how to use QuickBooks. You need to know how to think about marketing and all this kind of stuff. So traditionally, they've run their workshops face-to-face. But even before the coronavirus hit, they were beginning to do it online, because you think about, you know, farmers, they're dispersed all across New England, right? And so they couldn't always come down to the Boston area. So they were beginning to move online as well. And, you know, that kind of training doesn't, you know, it doesn't have to be expensive, right? You can use Zoom, right? You can use the free version, or you can pay $15 a month, which isn't that much. You know, people can just facilitate that pretty reasonably, and they get good ratings. So people feel there's value there. You know, they have experts who know farming and relate to them, and, you know, it's authentic and it's valuable. So, you know, pretty simple, not that expensive. Yeah, you can have these more complicated programs and, you know, do more with your e-learning than that, but that seems to work pretty well. I really think that's one of the trends in the industry. I don't know if I mentioned this in January, but, you know, there's now these platforms, and I don't even know what they're called or what they should be called, but they allow you to create courses online, and then you can sell them. If you're an expert in something, you can develop these on your own. There's an e-commerce engine in there. You can create your own, you know, short videos. You can have discussions. These systems set it up really nicely. And that's not a lot of, you know, it's not like, you know, developing something in the old days in authorware or you know, even Storyline and that kind of thing, because it's just much simpler.
There's a lot of different models for people who haven't done this kind of stuff in terms of online stuff to bridge over. And, you know, lots of folks are turning initially to these kinds of, you know, video based platforms. Something that I've been thinking about in relation to that is, and it relates to your research, though, in terms of like bringing in, say, that, you know, the spacing effect. We're currently right now, it seems to me anyway, there's a lot of video based stuff where it's just one and done, or it's, you know, yeah. It's informational dumping rather than actually, you know, moving people through something that we might prefer to call, say, a full learning experience or moving towards mastery of something, etc.
Well, yeah, you know, and, you know, we have to think about what we're trying to accomplish, right? If I need to know how to fix my toilet, right? I can go get a quick video. It's basically performance support.
Mm-hmm.
But if I need to know something deeper than that, you know, like leadership training or, you know, learning design or, you know, like my presentation science course, it's a 12-hour workshop to take people through what they need to know. That's, you know, that's significant investment because you need to really, you know, change the way you think about some things, and you can't do that on a quick thing. So the spacing effect, you know, it's a tool. What it's good for is enabling us to space repetitions over time so that people will remember. And if they don't need to remember, if they can just fix their toilet and be done with it, mm-hmm. then you don't need spacing. But most of the, you know, for real complex things, deeper things, you do need these sort of supports for remembering, and spacing is a really good opportunity.
Mm-hmm. I'm thinking kind of like, you know, being asked to be to train people in leadership or whatever. It's that's not a YouTube video lookup process, well, right?
Some people. Well.
Yeah, or a 15-minute little micro dump that you get mm-hmm. on your iWatch every week or so to brush up on your leadership.
Well, you know, I do wonder about, you know, can we pull that off? Can we pull off sort of a what I used to call, or you know, haven't had a chance to call lately, but subscription learning. So instead of, you know, in the old days when I was a leadership trainer, we would give people a 1-week workshop or a 1-day workshop on change management, or it would be part of a longer program, but over 4 months they'd get, you know, 1 week of training, and then they'd go back for a month, and then 1 week of training, they go back for a month. We did things like that. But what about having an online long-term conversation with a, you know, be more like a training, but sort of part like a coaching experience, and it'd be over time, and then you could build in those spacing effects. I wonder whether we can do that, whether we can keep people's attention for that long. You know, that's one of the advantages of training, putting people in a classroom. They're not distracted from the outside world. They really do have their attention. So I wonder about whether we can pioneer something like that, that people will really, you know, if it's really important to you, if you really want to be a better manager, then, you know, will you engage for a 6-month journey like that? I'm not sure. I'd like people to try it out, though.
Hmm. Well, I think it's not on, I mean, the folks who would commit to that are probably also someone who might commit to, say, a university program in that, or you know, that level of, you know, recognizing that they're already self-filtering, I would say, recognizing that, oh, I need this, and it's not a short, quick fix thing that I can get into.
Yeah. So I wonder what you guys think about, and what, you know, we've all seen about the industry, you know, when there's big catastrophes, you know, the stronger organizations survive and the weaker ones don't survive, or they get bought out or something. And already, even before the coronavirus, we saw a lot of mergers and acquisitions. Mm-hmm. And I know from talking to my fellow independent consultants that world has gotten harder and harder because organizations are using what's called like a trusted vendor.
Mm.
And they usually want a bigger company. And to actually hire somebody, you need to fill out all this paperwork. And, you know, it's good to have like a dedicated person that can do that kind of crap for us. So when people want to hire me, or people like me, and they're in a big organization, they want to hire me, they go, well, you know, it's going to be really hard, you know, because we got to go through all this paperwork. I can just hire Deloitte because we have a trusted thing with them, and I can get them on the phone tomorrow and they can be helping me out. So, you know, there's already been sort of this structural pressure on smaller players. And so there's been some mergers in the field. You know, I've heard this from people like Kate Graham of the Fosway Group, Lori Niles Hoffman, you know, so, but I, you know, I don't, have you seen that? Have you noticed that?
I don't know, Chris, what are you?
Yeah, well, my own world is fairly let's call it, I don't know, not blinders necessarily, but because we are, you know, a product creator, et cetera, that's the world that that I tend to be, you know, mostly focused in. We've certainly seen an increase in interest, you know, more hits on the website, those sorts of things, just as people are clearly trying to figure out how to do something new and different from that perspective. I don't, myself, I don't have a lot of connectivity, let's say, to that smaller, you know, consultant world directly, like you're describing, to be able to reflect on that trend.
There's got to be a way that, and I don't want to take us too far off track, but there's got to be a way that independents can become sort of trusted advisors too. I know I've worked with some folks, and I've tried to get certain clients, you know, in the past, I've tried to get clients to, you know, get on as a retainer, right? To just retain.
Oh, yeah. Love the retainers.
You know, and that's really hard to do. That's really hard from a consultant perspective, but it's kind of the same thing, right? If you're the trusted training person, it's like if they had a contract with Ernst & Young or whomever they're dealing with, except they have it with you as an individual, and you've committed to say, listen, I'll be here for you for this many hours, and you've got me locked in for them. You can use them or not use them.
Yeah, well, and I don't want to just focus on the independent consultants. Really, I see, you know, I sort of see this as there's some stressors in the industry right now. So, you know, my brother works for a company that does classroom training, right? And they've lost, you know, 90% of their business. And there's a lot of companies like that that are in a bad place out there. There's also companies, and maybe you can hear what people in the chat say. Maybe they've had experience with this. But there's also companies that are doing really well because they're positioned already. They were already doing virtual training. They have experts in it, true experts, not just, hey, I'm an expert. Mm. And they're doing well. So I just, you know, this, you were, we're talking here about structural predictions in the industry, and I think this is a big one. There's going to be big shakeups. There's the weak companies are going to either go out of business or going to hurt. Somebody's going to buy them. They're going to merge. You know, there's all kind of stuff going to happen. And I don't know what this means. It probably means that we as individuals in the field, particularly those who are losing jobs, we're going to have to, you know, get in the job market again. We all may need to change our skill sets to be better at online learning. So, you know, I'm running this conference now, I'd love to talk with your people about that. But one of my jobs in running this conference is to talk with potential speakers and recruit them. And, you know, one person I try to recruit, and she said to me, well, you know, I'm just not that comfortable teaching online. I'm a classroom person. I'm really great at that. I'm brilliant. I'm world class. But I'm not sure you want me for your online conference. And I'm like, what?
You better be world class, you know, online, I think. Hey, you know, there are a lot of folks out there, but it's a completely different skill set. It's a completely, well, maybe new skill set. And I think it is scary for a lot of classroom trainers to figure out how to get online and how to be as good as they are in person virtually. And we've got a lot of folks in our industry, in our community. I'm sure some of them are in the chat that have been doing this virtual thing for a long time, and they're trying to help people get better at it and to make that transition, right, from the classroom to being good at presenting virtually and dealing with the technology. But it's a huge transition, and it's not easy.
Yeah, look at Vicky in the chat says, I'm a traditional classroom trainer who creating e-learning modules as necessary, but I've seen a huge increase working with my clients to take things online.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Rachel says, I think people can take their skills and use them online. But there are some things, you know, I have to say, when I started out as a leadership trainer, I was horrible. You know, the CEO of my company, he accidentally sent an email around saying, and he sent it to me, accidentally included me in it. And he said, I don't want Thalheimer teaching too much. He's just not that good at it. And he was right, you know, but, you know, you need to improve your skills and over time, and it takes just going out there time after time after time, and you eventually get to be a really good classroom trainer. But now imagine you have to relearn everything. So you have to go up another steep learning curve. So just not that easy. It takes time.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. You know, I noticed we have a question in the ask a question section, Chris, and he was asking about asynchronous and synchronous. Do we use those terms? Or do clients actually use those terms? Or is that just something that we talk about? I kind of leave those words for just our circles of conversation. I've never heard a client say, we'd like to do some asynchronous training, please.
Yeah. No, I think our clients aren't using that. In fact, in the L&D conference 2020 that we're standing up now, we're having asynchronous sessions and synchronous sessions. And we've had a hard time figuring out what word to use for asynchronous. You know, self-study sounds too much like schooling, and mm-hmm. right? Self-paced sounds, I don't know, it's that's the best one we think we've figured out so far. And for synchronous, we just call them live sessions, which is a pretty good term. I don't know, if you, any help you can give, what's a better word than asynchronous?
Yeah. People, I have no idea what the answer is to that, because I've struggled with that too. I remember when I was at the eLearning Guild, we had these conversations a lot talking about what words do we use and what makes sense to the audience and how do you, you know, what, yeah, how do we even describe these things? And what's the difference between the terms we use as professionals and the terms we use for our marketing and selling our services and all of that? And
yeah, people are saying in the chat that self-paced is the best term they've heard too, so maybe mm-hmm. that's where we're going.
Yeah, maybe we just stay there. It's either self-paced or live.
Yeah.
And I, because we talk blended too, so you know, and I've noticed that the term blended has dropped into the chat quite a bit while we've been talking, but I don't think any of our clients understand what blended is. They just want training. And if we mix and match and in our minds do a blended solution for them, they don't call it blended. They just say, oh, that's the training we're buying from you.
Right. Well, you know, blended was a big term like 7 years ago or something. Right. And then everybody was using it.
But really, were your clients using it even back then when it was big? Were they asking?
Yeah, some were, you know, because people hear buzzwords and they go, I want that. I want blended. Okay. What do you mean by blended? Oh, well.
I want gamification.
Yeah, right.
True story.
Yeah. It's the year of gamification, by the way.
Yeah.
Oh, this is the year of gamification. Oh,
yeah.
Well, 2020 is in the lead on the leaderboard for gamification. But we'll wait to see. 2019 may make a comeback.
Well, yeah. You know, I didn't know about that. I guess I don't have my badges up to date.
That's right.
Micro learning. Thank you, Jill, for dropping that in there. Yes.
Yep.
We cannot forget about the micro learning.
It's a gamified micro learning blended platform,
right?
Indeed, all of them are. Well, I think at the end of the day, I think we can all agree that no matter what term you use and no matter what you're building for your clients, that design is the most important element of that. And if you don't get that instructional design piece right, it doesn't matter how you deliver it.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. You know, one of the other things, you know, with all this stress on the industry, it's going to be a big time for innovation, right? People are going to have permission to do things that they weren't able to do before. I think, you know, if you're working in a, well, no matter where you're working, you should, like, you know, not waste this crisis. If there's things you wanted to do for a long time, you wanted to use better evaluation, you wanted to use, you know, different technologies. You wanted to use, you know, spaced repetitions or more research-based things, and you had a hard time. Now is the time. Take advantage of this. It's your time to innovate, pilot test. We need to have more of an experimental mindset in this. In my upcoming book, The CEO's Guide to Training, E-Learning, and Work, I talk about how we in the field should be using A-B testing. But that the notion is, you know, try things out, see what works. You need better evaluation to get better feedback, but you know, that will help in this process. But it is the time for innovation. So if you're not innovating, you are, you know, you're wasting this crisis.
Well, isn't it? There's a bit of a dichotomy in that, and we got to be wrapping this up here, but. Some companies, and there's been a lot of layoffs and a lot of furloughs, and it's like training people are losing their jobs and being let go. But in other companies, they're ramping it up and going, oh my gosh, we need you, training, help us. You know, I'd be interested, I guess, in the chat to kind of see how people are feeling. My initial response when this thing all first started was, oh my gosh, this is an opportunity for training to shine. Like this is our moment. This is our moment to step up and say, we can solve this. We can help people work from home. We can help, you know, transition our skill sets into helping our workforce be scattered and work together, not only with training, but just in helping because we understand the technology more than most, right? So I was really, really, really hopeful, but then I started getting messages from people saying, well, our training department just got let go and I'm out of a job. And just, I went from being kind of, yay, this is our time to what just happened? People are like, out of jobs now and gone, and companies are like crushing the training department, and it just felt very strange to me.
Well, that's happening as well. When there's crises like these, sometimes training gets laid off. Or I sent an email to somebody, and the response, automatic response, because I'm furloughed till June 1st, and you know you were worried that that could probably go longer. So definitely, some people are being laid off, and but those of us left, we should innovate. I like that term. This is our time. You guys could get that on a coffee mug too. Maybe that's what I can put on my mug.
There we go.
All you have to do is write on that white one. That's the best part about a white mug. You can make it say whatever you want. Right, yeah, but it's good. I think, I think we've got some opportunities. And I'm wondering if in all of
you guys still there.
Oh, can you hear me?
I can, yes.
Oh, yeah. I'm wondering if in all the panic, if anybody has stopped for a moment and thought, how am I going to measure my success? Like at the end of this, has anybody thought, okay, we're going to, at 6 months down the road, we're going to have to look back and tell somebody how successful we were at helping the company get through this pandemic. I wonder, are people tracking certain things? Is there data in the works that we're looking at? Did people think
we should. And I can see my friend Denise Trakoff there in the chat talking about evaluation and how we measure that. I have not seen an uptick. I think everybody's flailing around. They need to create training and they're not thinking about evaluation. I would encourage people to update your smile sheets at least to performance-focused learner surveys, but do more than that. You know, I wrote a book on smile sheets, but I keep saying that's not all we should be doing. It's a great opportunity to use LTEM, the Learning Transfer Evaluation Model, and push ourselves up to not just measuring knowledge, but measuring decision-making and task competence. We can be doing that, you know, using scenario questions that are realistic, that are relevant. We can validate those. We can use those to get better feedback on how we're doing. And, you know, this is our time. Let's do these things, people. Let's do this good evaluation.
Let's do this.
I'm all in. Well,
excellent. Well, speaking of doing this, it's probably time for us to do our dance. And
time for us to get out of here. What a great conversation, Will. Mm-hmm. Thank you for sharing with us and helping us talk our way through this and out of it, hopefully, right?
You know, I hinted several times about my conference I'm standing up.
We'll put the details in.
I should probably tell people a little bit about that.
For sure. And throw the details in the chat, too.
You have a little time?
Yep.
So on March 7th, for those of you who don't know me, I do a podcast, Truth and Learning, with Matt Richter. We model it on Brett and Chris's podcast because, you know, top of the line. on March 17th, Matt and I got together and said, you know, this coronavirus is going to make a lot of face-to-face conferences be canceled. There's still a need in the field for people to get together and learn from the experts. And so we hired a brilliant marketing person, Ashley Sinclair, and we gathered great speakers, and we're trying to create a new kind of conference online, but it's not just a bunch of webinars. It's we're sort of taking a learning in the workflow approach, so you can come join the conference. You get asynchronous sessions with our featured speakers, and you wouldn't believe the people we have. Julie Dirksen, Patty Shank, Clark Quinn, Miriam Nealon, Connie Malamed, Kevin Yates, Sardiq Love, Myra Roldan, and a whole bunch of people. And I'm sorry if I'm forgetting their names, but I can't list them all. And so you learn some stuff, and then you get to take it back to your team, and you get to share it with them. And then you try it out, and you take your lessons learned, and you share those with others back at the conference. And if you hit some resistance, you take that back and you get feedback from your world-class speaker and other people in the conference. So we're really excited about this. People are interested. It's learningdevelopmentconference.com. And if you give me a second, I'll put that in the chat.
Yeah, for sure.
We're really excited about it. And Brent, you used to be in this world, but man, it's a lot of stuff to do to create a conference. So we're having a lot of fun.
And I can tell you, it is not an easy thing to do. And I give you all sorts of kudos, my friend, for jumping into the water and going virtual with it too, because it doesn't make it any easier. I can tell you, just because online, all the same work still has to be done. So.
Yeah, it's been fun though, I have to say. And the best part for me is to go recruit speakers and talk to people and hear about what's going on in the industry and what's going on in their world and their ideas for what to talk about, and just fantastic.
We love it.
Very cool.
You know, we're kind of like a virtual conference. We're here every Wednesday, 7 a.m. Pacific time, 10 a.m.
Eastern time.
Just put us on your calendar, everybody, and we'll be here next week again and doing this again. Thanks a lot, Will. Chris?
Hey, thank you, guys. Really great. Always good to talk with you.
Yeah, thanks, Will. Thanks for joining us. And we'll look forward to hearing how the conference went. Great. Dance away, everybody. Have a great rest of your weeks.
Everybody have a great day, great week. We'll see you next time.
We'll join you next week. Yep. Bye, guys.